everyone. Hi. I'm Adrienne LaFrance. I am the Atlantic's executive editor, and I am so happy to be able to welcome all of you to the Atlantic Festival, and delighted that you're here with us for the world premiere of Shadowland. Shadowland is inspired by the Atlantic series of the same name. It's a docuseries that's on Peacock now. You can watch all of it when you go home tonight, but for now, we'll watch the first episode. Joe Berlinger and his team at Radical Media sent reporters and documentary makers across the country to try to understand conspiracism in America. This is also a preoccupation of ours at The Atlantic, and we're just beyond thrilled to have worked with them and so glad for you all to get to see the first episode at the world premiere tonight. I have two practical notes for you. Please silence your cell phones and please stick with us because after the first episode, we'll regroup on the stage with Joe, who's here, and my colleagues from The Atlantic, Kaitlyn Tiffany and Adam Harris, who are staff writers. So we'll have a great conversation. But in the meantime, please enjoy Shadowland. Thank you so much.
A conspiracy theory is a theory that there is someone bigger that is pulling the strings.
There are wealthy, powerful families that control everything.
The Nazis are coming, they're here.
Our elections were stolen.
You devil-worshipping Satanist witch!
The rule of law in this country has been eliminated!
There's money to be made here.
People are dying that don't need to.
They are trying to manufacture anger.
I lost everything I ever worked for.
I miss my dad all the time.
This is really pulling people in.
I'm never gonna talk to him again.
Phew, how's everyone feeling after that? me again. Thank you all so much for being with us. It's now my great pleasure to introduce Joe Berlinger, the executive producer of Shadowland, as well as my wonderful colleagues, Atlantic staff writers Kaitlyn Tiffany and Adam Harris. All right. So I think where I want to start, only kind of see you, Kaitlyn, but I'll lean forward. I'll start with you, Joe. First of all, congratulations. I mean, it's a really spectacular and striking story that you're telling. And I want to start by asking about your level of optimism for our country, or alarm, either way, going into this project versus now being on the other side of it.
Great question. And thank you for having us, and thank you for all your great reporting, because your reporting inspired us to do the series. I've been very troubled by the degree to which half the country has a completely different view of reality. And it's been a concern of mine. And I was, concerned going into it and concerned coming out of it. I think we're in a very bad place. Obviously, democracy is based upon people with different views all coming together and agreeing what's good for the collective. And if you can't agree on basic facts, if you have a completely different version of reality, like a lot of, as we see in the series, Pauline believes she's the patriot. If it was just a bunch of criminals going to vandalize and steal stuff, that's almost easier to deal with. But the fact is, there's a good chunk of people in this country who believe the exact opposite of what I presume most of us here believe. And that's tearing the fabric apart of our country, of the foundations of democracy. In future episodes, we see how families are being torn apart. Friendships are being torn apart. Local politics, school boards is something we focus on. School boards are now places where people leave the school board meeting, and which you write about, and we cover you doing it. Where people who are on these school boards feel unsafe now. So
not tremendously optimistic.
So we are headed down a really bad place if we all can't, We have divided into two camps. We vilify one another. We look at each other in very two-dimensional ways. And historically, when a population, when citizens divide into camps and hate each other, which is where we're at, you know, bad things happen. I mean,
I want to go back in a minute to this question of sort of looking at each other in two-dimensional ways, because I think you have really, you know, put a lot of thought into how to portray people in this. But first, I'll go, and we'll go back to school boards too for Adam too. But first, Kaitlyn, maybe I'll ask you, because I know we've given this a lot of thought at The Atlantic in terms of our coverage of conspiracy theories. How do you think about finding the balance between making sure that the public is aware of a thing, even a fringe thing, or especially perhaps a fringe thing, without giving it more oxygen or without inadvertently glorifying it? Or how do you find the right balance journalistically there?
I feel like right after the 2016 election, there was sort of a rush by journalists and by a lot of people to understand the niche little seedy subcultures of the internet and maybe a little bit...
And I should say really quickly, Kaitlyn writes very deeply and brilliantly about internet culture and lots of like weird, you know, dark corners of the internet. But sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, so there came a point where any sinister thing that was happening felt like it was worthy of... you know, holding up into the light of like, look what I found, this, I found the latest scary thing. And I think people did come around to reconsidering that. And when we talk about stories at The Atlantic, like, we're not gonna cover a conspiracy theory just because it's the craziest thing we've ever seen. It's more like who's getting involved in this line of thinking? Is it a group of people that we haven't seen go down this road before? Or does this expose like an underlying political or cultural shift that we haven't seen with other conspiracy theories? I think in my reporting for Shadowland, I was pretty focused on women in like the Instagram mommy blogger multi-level marketing space who weren't really fitting into that same image of a conspiracy theorist that a lot of people had had previously, including myself. So it was valuable, I think, to explain to people how that could happen and why that would happen. And it's less about saying, you know, oh my God, look over here. Can you believe that anybody thinks this is true? And more like, well, what does it mean that anybody thinks this is true?
Right. I mean, you talked about the sort of like what could be revelatory in terms of cultural or political influence. But one of the things that's been striking to me about Shadowland and watching the series is that it's a reminder for me of the, I guess, sort of like what I'd call the politicization of everything. And Adam, I'm curious to hear you talk about that a bit. I mean, sort of a two-part question, if I may. One, are there conspiracy theories at this point that are untouched by politics that are worthy of, you know, I mean, maybe like Elvis Lives or something, but like, is my hunch right that conspiracy theories are more and more politicized the way everything seems to be? And then how does that play out? I mean, maybe talk about the school board thing or whatever else, but what are your thoughts there?
Yeah, I think one of the most interesting things about the ways that conspiracy theorists and conspiracy theories connect is that kind of connective tissue, right? If you start to go down a rabbit hole, then it's like, oh, well, this is clearly how this connects to this. And even if Elvis lives, right, Elvis lives because he's a part of this like broader...
he's coming back as Trump's running mate. I mean, that's not a real conspiracy.
It's not a real conspiracy. But considering, right, I would go to these meetings, or I've been to these school board meetings where you would have people talking about, well, clearly it was, it's been Dr. Fauci since the 1980s, and if you think about HIV and you think about the New World Order and you think about X and O, and they would just connect these dots in some really kind of bizarre ways, but to that circle of folks, like, it makes complete sense. And how that relates to, you know, school boards, how that relates to local politics, when you have folks who are willing to kind of go into a space that has traditionally been one of the few places that you are able to make your voice heard on a political stage, right? You can't go over to Congress and give a public comment, right? But you can go to your local school board meeting and provide a public comment. And when that sort of public comment turns into a sort of conspiracy hour, what does that do to the sort of fabric of your local politics? And as, you know, kind of understanding the broader, you know, broader democracy, what does that do if the basis of democracy starts to fray? What does that do to our larger democratic
and the project? Chilling effect probably too, right?
Exactly.
For people who actually do want to participate. I want to ask you, Joe, about obviously thinking about January 6th as a major part of this story makes sense. I'm curious for your, and I've thought about this a lot in my own coverage of QAnon, how did Donald Trump become the hero for so many people with conspiracist worldviews? Is it just because he himself is a conspiracy theorist, or is there something more to it, do you think?
Well, I think he's been masterful, as have a lot of politicians who know better, about politicizing the people who have been left behind. You know, there's a grain of truth in many conspiracy theories, and the biggest conspiracy theory of all is that there's a lot of helicopters, and they're here to observe me. Just kidding.
It takes on a sort of post-apocalyptic
okay.
vibe now.
All right.
We've
that helicopter is filming me. No, I'm just kidding. You know, the biggest conspiracy theory of all, and then everything always seems to lead back to, you know, there's a cabal of wealthy families controlling everything. And people who have been left behind, or who, you know, this country has not done a great job for the people who are, you know, hanging on, you know, healthcare and financially disadvantaged people. And I think Trump and other politicians have masterfully exploited that. You want to feel like there's a sense of belonging. You want to feel like there's a greater purpose and that there's an explanation for why my life has not turned out and why other people have greater advantages. So I think they've just tapped into that, you know, brilliantly, you know, evilly and brilliantly.
To what extent do you see the folks in the series who are conspiracy theorists as victims?
Well, that's a great question. I mean, look, the whole design of the series is, you know, we wanted to treat people as three-dimensional human beings. I wanted to have, in fact, I was a little unnerved. This is the first time we've shown it publicly as opposed to just dropping something on TV, and people were in the audience were laughing, and I'm kind of, just to be honest, the laughter is not the emotion I was looking for. You know, I really wanted to do something with a great team of filmmakers, and I should say my pals at Radical Media here, who did a great job. I just want to give an applause to them. You know, if we don't start talking, I mean, again, we have divided into camps and treat each other like the enemy, and that can't be good. We have to start talking. So the intent of the series was really to, you know, go out into the world and not point a finger and say, look at you crazy people. It's really, how did we get to this place where a good number of people, you know, really believe these things? I find that deeply disturbing, you know. So the idea of the show, and you talked about how do you, you know, with Kaitlyn, how do you do the balance? Because that was a big issue for us. Oh, the QAnon's back. No, I'm just kidding. You know, you have to, in this show, I wanted people to, you know, not, I didn't want to give oxygen to the conspiracy theories, but you want people to be treated like three-dimensional human beings so that we can promote some dialogue, you know?
I want to stay on that, the topic of empathy for a minute and go to Adam and Kaitlyn. Maybe Adam, you can go first on this, but I share your view to, I think, a large extent that you should treat people, especially when you're approaching them journalistically or in a documentary series, with empathy and an open mind and respectfully. At the same time, just as a citizen or someone thinking critically about sort of the dynamic in our country right now, we also know that shaming people is a powerful tool for keeping, you know, social order or whatever. And both of you are extremely online. And so I'm curious what you think in terms of, you know, there's sort of this interesting tension that with the social web, you have the democratization of publishing and many voices can be heard, and yet, is that being used for good or ill in this? I mean, clearly the spread of conspiracy theories is dangerous, but there's also a space where you're seeing people calling people out. I mean, where do you find the balance between let's all listen to each other and try to understand versus like, this is nonsense, let's call it what it is?
Yeah, I think one of the things that I always try to do when I go into a story is to generally try to understand where someone's coming from, right? And what you just saw, right, is that the sort of conspiracy exists in the void that was created by the uncertainty that these people were feeling, right? A sort of need for a purpose, a need for, and trying to understand that is important because it's like the conspiracy ultimately becomes kind of like the symptom of that deeper problem. And like the deeper they go into the conspiracy, it becomes the top line problem. But kind of understanding first and then saying, you know, correcting or offering the truth, and if they're not willing to accept what is actually going on, then that's the point where you know when you're going into writing a story, you can write through it and say, this is the thing that this person believes, this is why they believe it, this is why it's false, this is why it's not true, but you know, what are the ways that we can help people not be sucked into this vortex and continuously be pulled into this vortex of conspiracy?
Kaitlyn, please, no, go ahead.
Oh, sorry, no, I have a slightly different view because I think we have a major societal problem that needs addressing, and I think we are all part of the problem. You know, I look at, you know, conspiracy thinking, and to me it goes back a couple of decades of where the problem started. Quite specifically, there was once a very clear line between entertainment and news. If you go back to the era of Walter Cronkite, there was, you know, the news division at networks was the gift that the American people got because the FCC provided a license, and profit making in the news division was just unheard of. At a certain point, that line started to fall. News became big business, the 24-hour news cycle, the explosion of cable networks, the introduction of opinion into the news, and I think that conditioned our society to like not really know what the truth is. And then that intersects with social media. And social media is, on the one hand, is an amazing thing. When I was a kid, like the idea of something like this, you know, only people on Star Trek had personal communicators. The fact that you can, you know, go like this and find out any piece of information is amazing, but it's also flooded with disinformation because of social media. And all of this has contributed to a lot of people being deeply confused. And unless we start having empathy to people who are deeply confused, and unless we hold our leaders who are responsible for manipulating these people accountable, that's where the accountability, I believe, needs to be. But there's a lot of people who I think are victims, and I think it's a larger societal issue of how the media landscape has evolved.
Kaitlyn, we were just talking about this. I don't mean to cut off your applause. We were just talking about this. How much do you blame the internet? How much should we blame the internet or the social web versus human nature versus cable versus Jon Stewart or any other factors?
Yeah, I guess it's sort of the question that's been dogging everybody for years at this point. But as somebody who like has spent a lot of time on the internet, spends a lot of time on the internet every day, like has written about feeling lonely and going to the internet for community or something to do with my time and emotions, or like even as a journalist whose job is like in some ways not dissimilar from somebody who's piecing together a big narrative from little pieces that they find in sometimes exhilarating ways. You know, like I understand the allure. I think like it would be silly to say that it's kind of either or. I think in decades before the internet, like all of these conspiracy theories had their own iterations applied to different events, you know, like the Red Scare, or, you know, there were freakouts about nuns trafficking children and child sex trafficking rings in the 1890s or whatever. Like these things always existed, but you would have had to work a lot harder to find the kind of community that would reward you for your like powers of observation and your commitment to a moral cause, and you know, it just didn't have the same ease of taking off as joining a Facebook group, or you know, being rewarded on Instagram with a lot of followers, which thankfully I think they've kind of like they've kind of shut down that a little bit, but there are still spaces where you can get a lot of affirmation for participating in these theories, and I think also people who are just confused by the rapidly changing state of the world and have beliefs that they know are not appropriate to express, like, will mask them with conspiracy theories. So people who don't believe in a multiracial democracy wanted to believe that the election was stolen, or you know, people who don't consider trans people to be like full human beings believe in like these conspiracy theories about children's hospitals, and they're able to couch it in this kind of like moral or just cause. And I think people have used that for decades, for centuries, for forever.
Right. Well, I mean, and to your point, like, I mean, there were anti-Semitic conspiracy theories in, during the Crusades, and the way they spread was that, like, the town preacher would ride a horse to the next town, and it's much, in terms of speed and scale, they just simply couldn't spread as quickly as, obviously, today. A question I wanted to ask each of you that I don't think I've ever asked any of you is, inspired by Ellen Cushing, our colleague who you saw tonight and was a big part of Shadowland and helped run that series for The Atlantic, so I just wanted to give her a shout out. She's amazing. But she talks about her own dabbling in conspiracy theories as a teenager. Have you, Joe, ever been swept up in a believing a conspiracy theory?
Yeah, about 5 minutes ago when those
You're a chopper conspiracy.
I am a gullible person at times, and I have like gone down some rabbit holes and then recovered. But you know, there's an allure to it. You want to make sense of the world. You want to feel like you're onto something. So when I was younger, I will admit there were a few things that, you know, chemtrails and things like that.
Sure.
That. You know, seemed more real than I would say now that I'm a little older.
How about you,
Adam? And wiser.
Yeah, well, there was an experience when I was maybe like about 12 or 13 where one of my sister's friend's parents invited us over, my entire family, and they showed a video about Illuminati.
Okay.
And, you know, I didn't believe in it at that point, but it was just interesting because these were very educated folks who had come to believe in this sort of broader conspiracy theory. But yeah, I don't 100% know that I dabbled in it.
I want to ask Kaitlyn, but I fear Joe's latest conspiracy theory is going to interrupt us. But Kaitlyn, how about you?
I don't. You know, I get into like the celebrity conspiracy theories. Like, was Avril Lavigne, did she fake her death?
Okay, I think we're good.
Oh, people might have missed this one, but there was a conspiracy theory that Avril Lavigne faked her death and was like replaced by a doppelganger. That one was pretty popular when I was in college, you know, like wink, wink, ironically, but also like, could it be? So.
And how about you?
Oh, fair question. You know, I've always been interested in conspiracy theories. I don't think I've ever like really believed one, but I have written about them since, for as long as I've been a journalist. And I remember post 9/11 being really interested in, like almost immediately, those of you who are old enough to remember will remember this. The internet was still, like news sites were barely news sites. Most of the news was coming through TV. But there were the first few sort of like massively viral images that circulated post 9/11 that it was the first time that I found myself on the internet being like, is this real? If not, what, like who's circulating it? And so I think that's part of what at least got me more interested in like why people would spread them in the first place. Okay, more questions for you guys. I wanted to ask, you got at this a little bit, but maybe I'll go to you, Adam. What do you think we should do? How do we get out of this mess that we're in?
That's a small, just a little
just
small
a
question.
Tiny
yeah,
question.
Yeah, tiny question
for you.
As you know, both Joe and Kaitlyn have mentioned kind of social media as an accelerant, and one of the things that I was talking about in that sort of void that is created by uncertainty, I've talked to several parents who have, you know, started to delve into conspiracy theories, and that came out of, you know, post-school shutdowns, right? They would go to school board meetings, and then they would have meetings in the parking lot after and find people who were like, oh, well, you should join this Facebook group where we have these sort of conversations. I think social media companies, of course, have a lot of responsibility
here. So, like, trying to find people to set them straight, or...
I think they would find people who would help drive them into further conspiracy.
Okay.
And then they would start connecting dots, and you would, after you sort of ask them enough questions, they would tell you where all the dots were that were supposed to connect. But I mean, with the sort of accelerants that we have at this moment, it's incredibly difficult to find one sort of panacea is one sort of solve for the entire issue. I think one of the early things that we could start to do, we don't really have community spaces that people are gathering across political lines. I think that could be helpful, but you're also that is what a school board meeting was traditionally, right? You have people who had different ideas. And I think that those local spaces have been frayed to a point where it's very difficult to come back.
Yeah, one of the things that I've heard repeatedly from researchers who study this phenomenon is that just to ask questions. So when you encounter someone sort of spouting conspiracy beliefs, saying something like, oh, like, how many people would have to be in on this for it to be true? And of course, one would think that the person asking the questions would have to be someone that person trusts and all the rest. But Joe, I'll go to you with a version of the same question. I mean, how do we solve all of our problems in the country?
Right, it's not, there's no easy answer. But I also think all of this intersects with, our political process has been corrupted by money and influence to the point where our democracy, now I sound like a conspiracy theorist, is barely recognizable. And I think if people on the lower rungs of society who from healthcare to other financial issues, if we took better care of one another, as Pollyannish as that sounds, I think that would go, a lot of these things come out of discontent, and there's a lot of discontent in this country, and part of it is because, a lot of decisions are being made that are don't sync up with the popular vote. Not vote, but,
sentiment.
Sentiment, thank you. Like, our political processes have been corrupted by money, and I think if we can start to get a handle on some of those issues, less people will feel so massively disconnected and discontented that, I think 15% of the country, if you believe the polls, 15% of the country believe that most people in this audience, I'll assume, are blood-drinking pedophiles, I mean, it's just large numbers of people have just such a bizarre worldview, and I think it comes from dissatisfaction with their own existence.
Well, and I mean, to your point about money, I think you mentioned sort of people's economic conditions. Kaitlyn, to what extent do you think the sort of periods of high conspiracism are correlated or prompted by highly visible wealth disparity? Because that's certainly a condition of the present.
Yeah, there was a study in the 90s that found that people were particularly susceptible to conspiracy beliefs if they felt that they could lose their job in the next year. So moments of instability and crisis really bring these things to the surface. I think, I'm kind of two minds about that, because obviously it's a factor. At the same time, I think it can be a little bit condescending at a certain point to excuse ideas or beliefs that are rooted in bigotry or just blind venom towards the press and the government and towards your fellow citizens just because of economic causes. And that's sort of the same trap I think people fell into in explaining how Trump was elected in the first place. But yeah.
Adam, where do you see the line between conspiracy theorizing and the culture wars? And I ask this, I know that sounds like a giant question, but I mean more in the spirit of it's evident that mainstream politics now certainly you know, there's a lot of fear-mongering. I suppose that's not new. But we've really seen conspiracism sort of, like, taken away from the fringe and put into the mainstream.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, it, I wonder, is that a legitimizing force? Or does it just mean everything's more fringe now? Like, how do you think about how that all kind of affects us culturally?
Yeah, I think that you know, it does mean that kind of everything's more fringe now. And sorry to keep going back to education, but of course, it's you know, I often think about the way that critical race theory was turned into this sort of boogeyman, right? You had an academic theory that was basically understanding the way that sort of the structural racism of the past did not stay in the past, but it still informs our kind of present situation. And it was turned into a sort of catch-all for anything that resembled a discontent for a certain subsection of the American population. And it allowed some of those fringe ideas to sort of imbue the comments that you now hear during school board meetings. You will hear in the same breath that the Nazis are here as well as they're teaching my child to hate them. And those two are not, it's very difficult to separate those two ideas for a lot of people at that point.
Do you think, like, conspiracy theories have also become so, it used to be sort of a fringe thing to cover journalistically as well, and it's so mainstream now that it's almost lost meaning, like, in the same way that disinformation or, like, other, like, truly crucially important things that we should be thinking about and addressing become sort of buzzwordy. I wonder, Joe, how you think about making sure that people don't just kind of glaze over when they, oh, like, oh, yeah, conspiracy theories.
Well, that is why, you know, we did this series, and we wanted to take people inside, and instead of just finger pointing, really try to, you know, not condone the conspiracy that's being articulated, but to really get a sense of why people believe and how they believe. And I think if there's more dialogue about it, we have to get past, I know I sound like a broken record, but we have to get past the vilification. Certainly people who know better, there are, you know, as we see in Shadowland, there's a lot of people in it to sell products, a lot of people in it to make money, a lot of people in it for political gain. All that, those people should be absolutely held to account. But we have to get beyond just this vilification and start understanding how to be a country again, because, you know, I don't see it getting better, you know, I just see it getting a lot worse.
Well, that is not the most cheerful note to end on, and we still have 1 minute, so I will ask, maybe I'll stick with you, Joe, what reason do you see for hope? Having been through making the show with your colleagues at Radical Media and thinking about this deeply for so long, what gives you the most hope despite how very dark things can be?
Well, you know, historically we've gone through waves of hating each other and having different versions of reality, and I just, you know, ultimately have faith in us as a people that we will eventually come together. You know, I just hope in this next election cycle it doesn't slide into the kind of violence that we've never seen before. But I think
hope. We're staying on hope.
I know, but I think if we stick with it, you know, we'll get through it. You know.
No, I'm with you. I mean,
I don't want to be overly hopeful because I think it's a dire situation that we're in. You know, I don't want to pretend that it's going to be good.
Yeah, no, I'm right there with you. Well, on that note, thank you all so much for being here. Thank you to our panel. And don't forget to watch on Peacock. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you guys so much.
Thank you. Great job.